And we
His shows are designed to shock and confuse with large-scale optical illusions that leave thousands of fans in awe. Among his biggest, making space shuttles appear to disappear, and the Taj Mahal some years later.
There is real magic here.
Meet Franz Hararay. As a master of spectacle, his craft has been likened to counterpart David Copperfield, but his work may have arguably been seen by more people. Creating illusions for concerts around the world, he's worked with throngs of A-list stars like Missy Elliott.
This is my man, Franz.
Michael Jackson and Usher. Today, after almost three decades in the game, his illusions keep growing, keeping his multi-million dollar productions and brand of magic constantly in demand.
It's magic time.
Time to turn off gravity.
Hey. Here, I want to introduce to you my friend JB. Are you in Manila?
I am in Manila, Philippines, Franz.
Manila. And for those of my friends watching this, this is the JB show. This is not TikTok. This is specifically for JB, for the magicians of Manila and the Philippines and all of his friends throughout Asia and Southeast Asia. So, JB. Yeah. Take it away. It's all you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon from Manila. And this is Inspire Magic Talk Live together. We're going to be hearing from the main man, the master magician, the illusionist, Mr. Franz Harary. So thank you very much, Franz, for having me here. It was such a pleasure. I know you're very busy with all the quarantine shows. Congratulations on that. It was amazing. And today, Filipinos are going to be inspired with your story, right? So we'd like to get to know you more, and we can ask questions later. And we have David. Hi, David, saying hi. So, Franz, first of all, how are you guys doing there in LA? What time is it?
Well, you say I'm very busy, but the truth is not really. I'm kind of going out of my mind. This is my office here in my home in Los Angeles. And I'm going crazy. So the fact that you called and said, let's do this, it is a welcome diversion, you know. By the way, you were telling people to bring in their questions later. They can bring them in now.
Yeah, I can see people
just shooting them in. And as we see questions, we can just start grabbing them.
Correct.
Yeah, and let me say it is truly a delight to be here with you at 10:30 at night, L.A. time. And if I can say nothing else, I would say let this little Q&A that we're doing, let there be no sacred subjects. In other words, anything you want to talk about, bring it on. I'm right here.
Yeah. Okay, first, of course, we just want to know the early days of Franz Hararay's career. How did you get hooked into the magic industry? So would you tell us a brief history on how you started with this?
Sure. Well, when I was 13, this happened for all of us, I think. When we were little kids, I was 13.
Yeah.
I got a magic set for my birthday. And I was fascinated not with how these tricks work, but why they work. You know, the psychology behind them. At 13, I didn't understand that we're talking about psychology. But as time went on, I came to realize that's really what this is all about. Yeah. And very quickly, I decided that I wanted to invent my own tricks and create my own magic. So I started experimenting and playing with the different little toys in this magic set to see if I can come up with new things. And then it just grew and grew from there. And then a fella named Doug Henning showed up on American television.
Doug Henning.
You know Doug Henning? I wanted to be Doug Henning. So I was determined to be an illusionist. But of course, you know, my folks didn't have any money. So I found old cardboard boxes, you know, refrigerator boxes and any big box that I could find. And I tried to figure out how to make my own illusions out of cardboard boxes. And I kind of just learned by failing, you know. And then that ran from there. I was going to school. By that time, I was in high school and then in college. I studied music. Theater. I thought I was going to go to New York and go to Broadway. So I was studying opera and voice. And as I was studying music, I was also able to convince like the head of the symphony orchestra or the opera department or the marching band into allowing me to create magic with these groups. So with that, I taught myself how to do magic for very, very big shows. And all this is going on during college. Finally, and finally, Michael Jackson announces that he's going out of here. He burns his hair in a Pepsi commercial. You might be just a little bit too young.
I think I've heard of that. I saw that as well,
When he said the name of the attorney on television, I called the attorney, and then the attorney led me to another guy and another guy. And the whole time, I'm saying, my name's Franz. I'm a 20-year-old magician, and I know how to create big magic, and I want to create magic for Michael. So eventually, I got to the right guy. I sent a video of magic that I had designed for a football game, you know, outside in a field. And from that, I met Michael, became his friend, became his magician, never finished the university, moved out to Los Angeles, and started designing magic for pop concerts. And there's sort of the compressed story right there for you.
Wow, that's an amazing story, man. So you really started your humble beginnings. So I think I really do believe that everyone should start from there. But the thing there is, how did you get known to superstars like Michael Jackson?
Well, it's being Michael's friend. I was sort of in that clique, you know? So the next thing, I got a call from Janet Jackson. I have the recording somewhere on an old voice recorder. I don't even know me. My name is Janet. But then kind of in there, one star introduces you to their friends, and it just keeps going. And then it was Prince and Madonna and LL Cool J.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
Usher and Justin Timberlake. And it just keeps going. In fact, before this whole COVID-19 thing happened, I was working with Missy Elliott, an American rapper, pop star. She, I've been working with for 19 years. She's done, I think we've done around 17 or 18 different concerts together. Okay. And she does illusions. She does my magic in all of her concerts. So at this point, I think she's done more actual different illusions than pretty much any other illusionist in Vegas right now.
Wow.
And, you know, it's been one at a time over the course of a lot of time. But it's great to have that relationship, you know. So I know when she goes on tour, I'll get the call.
Yeah, the next question is how to be you. No, I'm just kidding. So, Franz.
How to be me? You don't want to be me.
That's the usual joke here in the Philippines. How to be you, man. It's someone look up to you. So, being a magician, of course, I know you mentioned Do Henning, right? So, is he the main influence for you doing magic? Have you ever done close magic before also?
In the beginning, it was Henning. But then once I realized that I can invent this stuff myself, and once I kind of got hooked by that bug, this is going to sound ridiculous, but I kind of started looking away from other magicians because I didn't want to copy them. I didn't want to be like other magicians. And I found my real influences to be, you know, like Steven Spielberg, James Cameron, you know, because, I mean, Spielberg has an amazing formula. It's basically to take an ordinary person and put them into an extraordinary situation, right?
Yeah.
I thought, how can I use this formula in creating my own illusions, my own magic? And even still today, I see magic everywhere, but it's not on stage, and it's certainly not with other magicians.
Yeah.
Because I try to make sure that there's no imitation there, you know?
Yeah.
Now, the bad thing about that is I end up reinventing the wheel a lot. You know, I don't subscribe to any magic magazines or any of them. But the problem there is sometimes I'll be working on a design for months, and I'll show some drawings to a friend of mine, and they'll say, oh, you know, that's like the blah, blah, blah Kevin James thing. And it's like,
How do you deal with that? Yeah, how do you deal with that? Are you still gonna proceed with it or
no? That's the price I pay for being as isolated as I am. You know, it's
Yeah.
I know that feeling of having your stuff copied, of having it ripped off. My stuff is continuously being ripped off. And of course, you hear that, copying, imitation is a form of flattery. Yeah. It really just makes me nuts, and it makes me so angry. And so you try to protect it, and you try to legally protect it as much as you can. And now I've got a system where through my attorneys, I kind of have a thing. But it took a long time to get to that, and it really burned up a lot of my energy and a lot of my soul.
Yeah, I am as well,
You know, it's as a magician in this community, if there's anything that I can preach, it's that we've got to respect each other, and we cannot rip each other off, because the community is too small, you know?
Yeah, that's good.
I see a bunch of questions are coming
up. Franz, Dale Rubio is here from the Philippines, so he's one of our top magicians here.
Ah, hey, Dale.
His question is this. Is that Franz Hararay poster from your Manila tour at the back? From the
Yeah, where is it? Right there.
Yeah.
There it is. Ta-da!
Maybe George Mamluk and the Prestidigitator's Chubster, they're going to bring you back soon, you know?
Hey, the Chubster. I haven't talked to him a long time.
I know, he's kind of busy. Yeah, that is designed by James Paul, that poster. So shout out to James Paul. Yeah. So here's another question here. I got a message from Mac Florendo. Okay, how do you choose the effects for your show?
How do I choose? Well, I don't choose. It's not like I go online and I go, well, I'll do one of those and one of those. I've got this. It's an obsession, maybe, only doing my own magic. The idea of doing someone else's magic, I respect other guys if they can make a living doing it, but for me, it feels like I'm painting by number, you know? It feels feels like I'm a karaoke singer, you know? There's nothing rewarding in it. I just don't understand it. I have nothing wrong with go buy a Kevin James bowling ball. It's a great trick. But once you've designed something, once you've created something that is yours from your mind, from your heart, once you put that onto a stage and refine it and mold it, when you get that reaction, when you get that applause from the audience, it is such an energy rush.
Yeah.
Nothing else compares to it. Because they're no longer applauding for you because you're a guy in a nice jacket waving his fingers. Mm-hmm. Now they're applauding your art and your blood and sweat and your vision.
Yeah.
And that's so rewarding that once you've had that fix, that's it. You can never happily do other people's magic. So to answer the question, really the question is, where does new stuff come from? Where do new designs come from? And they come from life. They come from just everywhere. You know, when I was in Manila not too long ago, we went to the Ayala Museum, right? And they had so many cool displays there. And what I noticed even more so than what was on display was the art design within the displays. I thought it's a whole new approach. And I go, there's something here, you know? So I'm always looking for that. I'm always looking for new imagery and new ways of looking at things, and then trying to apply those to some formula that allows me to put it on a stage. That's a very long answer for a very short
time. Yeah, we learned a lot. You know, you mentioned about the card boxes illusions. Like you started with those cheap, what do you call this, budgeted
card boxes, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and you evolved. I'm sure you evolved from MAB slowly as you raise money for that, right? So how do you evolve from you know, building your own? And then do you ever purchase any large illusion, the first one when you were starting?
No. I did cardboard pieces. And then once I kind of got good at cardboard magic, then I kind of graduated to cheap plywood because, again, I'm still poor at this point, you know? Then once I kind of got good with plywood, I kind of little baby steps, you know, but it was always a money issue, you know. When I was in junior high school, I cut up three card Montys, you know, the two cards,
Yeah.
sold them to my junior high school. Everybody in junior high school I could sell so that I could make like $150 or $200. And I used that money to buy wood for a zigzag that I built.
That's my smart.
So really, I guess the first illusion that I built that had any kind of value to it was a zigzag, mm-hmm. and a zigzag from Robert Harbin, who is an absolute god. I learned so much from that, but I also learned that I wanted to do my own stuff. I was happier doing cardboard box magic that was my own creation than I was doing Robert Harbin's zigzag.
So I thought,
this is good, but I got to go back to doing my own stuff, you know?
That's a good. Hey, I just want to say hi to Jamie Allen. He's saying hi to both of us, Franz.
Hey.
You know who he is, right?
And of course.
I am a magician. Of course, from the Philippines, Lou Hilario is tuned in, and he's saying something. Lou Hilario is our top magician here. He says, first time I saw Franz on TV was more than 30 years ago. Performing the lighted rod through body illusion.
Oh my God. I hear this more and more. It kills me. You know what? I hear grown up adult people coming up to me and going, Mr. Harary, I grew up watching you on television. Like, oh my God. How did that happen? When did I become old?
Well, you know what? There's another one. Franz, how did you get the idea of making your house of magic in Macau? From Anshai Kumbawa.
It didn't start out as that. It started out as that. Well, it sort of did. I was doing a show in Atlantic City in the United States. And I realized that if you're over 40 years old and you don't drink alcohol, there's not a lot for you to do. You know, you're going to go to buy it. I don't drink. And so it's like, all right, there are others like me. So I came up with this idea to create a magic club that was like a cross between a magic club and really a strip bar, you know, with semi-naked girls. Because I thought the guys will go there for the hot girls and women will go there and allow the guys to go there because it's a magic club.
It's a wise. So,
I designed this whole thing, and then I went out to try to sell it, and I discovered that nobody is buying that. So it kind of changed and morphed, and it became bigger and bigger, and then I found myself in Dubai and learned that it's easier to sell something big than something small. So I ended up growing, and the concept kept growing until it was almost the size of Disneyland. It was a very, very big theme park based on that. So now I'm jumping around Malaysia, Indonesia, Manila, all over China, Tokyo, trying to sell this theme park based on magic. Having a hell of a time because the price, the ticket is so big. And so it started to shrink smaller and smaller, and it got smaller and smaller until finally it became the House of Magic, which is basically a theme park, but all encapsulated within a pretty small area. Because it was five different areas that people could go to and experience magic in different ways. And then from there, so once I did the House of Magic, we finished that run. Now I go, okay, now I understand what this can be, what magic can be.
Yeah.
So my next project is in Sanya, China. And it just opened up. It just opened. We opened on January 21st. We got these amazing reviews, the greatest reviews of my whole life. And 3 days later, on the 24th, Chinese government shuts us down. So it's like, oh my God. So the whole show is sitting in deep freeze. It's when we finished the show, we got the message. All of the equipment was already preset to do another show. Costumes are preset. Props are preset. Everything was preset. And they said, nope, that's it. You're done. So we got my whole cast, about 30. My cast is about 30, and there's another 70 Chinese people. We got all of my guys out of the country as fast as possible. By the way, I've got four guys from Manila working for me. So they all went back to the Philippines and all over Asia and the States. And right now, still, that show is frozen. If you go to the theater, it looks like time stopped. You know, it looks like Chernobyl. And as I'm talking about this, I know that my engineer has a clip of that show.
Okay.
And I'm something that maybe we can bring it up.
Maybe, yeah. So, maybe we can bring it up.
Yeah, it's like a little... No, wow. That's what it was until we got shut down. So all that is sitting there waiting.
Excited for, you know, for this crisis to end, you know, and just go to China
well,
to watch the show.
I am incredibly fortunate because I know when this is done, my whole company and I, we've got a gig to go back to in China.
I know.
All of my friends in magic, it's not that, you know, everybody's going, holy crap, what happens next?
Yeah.
Where do we go next? What's what does entertainment do? What does magic do?
Yeah.
How do we survive? So
I think
a lot of things are gonna change. I think people, magicians in magic are gonna have to relook at what they do and figure out how to deliver a product in a world economy that's different. In a place where you can no longer touch your volunteers, you know? Mm-hmm. How do you do that? How do you do a show without touching somebody?
I know. That was just a topic with Jeff McBride in your quarantine show. So I have, there's Tito Chris Castro is online, one of our top magicians here. And he says, hi, Franz and JB. I was one of those Filipino who worked with Franz in Happy Valley, Shenzhen, and Beijing. I don't know if you remember
him. My gosh. Yes. It was a while ago. Castro.
Yeah,
nice to see you again.
Yeah, we have Albert Tam also. House of Magic was a magical experience, you know, Albert Tam.
Hey, Albert.
Yeah, so that was good.
How did you know about this? Because I didn't tell any of my friends about this broadcast. How does Albert know?
I made some promotion.
Oh, there you go.
Just like magic. So, Franz, no, doing all that, you know, how you started, the first illusion was a cardboard box, and then you fund it from your own money, and then, you know, how do you get booked? Your first show. I mean, can you still remember your first ever show? Was it a free show, or how did you do it?
So many free shows. I did birthday party shows. I remember.
Oh, that's good.
The first money that I ever made was I got $5 US to do a friend of the family's kid's birthday party show, and so I thought, well, this is my big chance. So I brought in myself and like three or four of my friends to act as technicians and assistants. Mm-hmm. And of course, I brought in all of my cardboard box illusions that I had built. And it took like all afternoon. It probably took 5 or 6 hours to set up this mini illusion show in some lady's basement. I went out. You know how dry ice is? The smoke, ground smoke?
Yeah.
I had dry ice in this lady's basement. And I had pyro and, you know, pyrotechnics in this lady's basement. So I quickly learned the economics of this because it cost me about $35 to do the show, but I only got $5. So very quickly that lesson started to be taught. I haven't learned the lesson yet because I'm still spending way too much money, you know?
Yeah, that's for the love of it. So I guess, you know.
Right.
But
I did birthday parties. We've got Danny Morano. He's somebody you want to talk to.
Yeah, Danny Morano is online.
Danny is arguably the number one children's performer in the Los Angeles area.
Wow. Hello, Danny.
Millions and millions of people within his markets. And he's rich. He does so many shows. And he does so much magic in so many basements that
he's laughing out loud.
You want to be Danny Morano. That's who you want
to
be.
Oh, and I want to talk to Danny soon.
But anyway, I did a lot of these birthday parties, and it just kind of kept growing. And then as I was doing birthday parties and weddings and anything I could, I was going to school to study music. And so, as I was saying, in the university, that's where I was able to really experiment and really kind of develop, you know, my magic.
Yeah. Hey, I want to say hi to Ron Salamanquero, one of our great magician and creator in the Philippines. And he says, my hero, Franz Harary. So you are your hero.
Oh, you got to get bigger heroes.
Yeah, that's Ron Salamanquero. So wow, man. So with all that thing, now you are who you are now, Franz. I mean, you are a magician's magician, a teacher. You're a hero from most of us or all of us.
To him.
Yeah, that's him. No, to me as well, man. You know, when I first started this Inspired Magic Talk with you, the first person that I was praying for that you would not snub me as you. So I contacted you, and you know that, right? So
I do. You know. Oh, let me tell you something. Firstly, because of you, I started doing my own show right here on this channel called Quarantine Talk. And since I started, I've had Jeff McBride and Kevin James and Shin Lim's going to be on, and all these pretty big names in magic. And I'm discovering that all my friends, just like me, are locked in their house with nothing to do. So Quarantine Talk is on pretty much every night at 9 o'clock New York time. What is that for you?
Maybe 8 a.m.
You've been watching it. What time?
8 a.m. in the morning. I don't like 8
that. 8 a.m. Oh, my gosh. That's early. So 8 a.m. for you right here on this channel. Tomorrow I've got Victor and Diamond. The next day, Gabe Blackstone. You know Gabe Blackstone?
Yeah.
The assistant producer, wife of Harry Blackstone. Then on Tuesday, I've got Shin Lim and Jeff Hobson's coming and Murray Sacha. So come right here, 8 o'clock in the morning. You got to get up early, 8 o'clock in the morning, and bring in your questions to Quarantine Talk.
That's good.
I'll be doing that. Also, while I'm doing my pitch here, like me. Press the like button.
Like the page. Smash it. Like Franz Hararay fan page.
I'll wait right now. We'll just wait for you to smash it.
Yeah, just like it.
Like it. Yeah. Like the
Well, thank you for saying that, you know, that I inspired you to do the quarantine show. But
Yes. Oh, so that's what I was going to say. So, honest to God, this is the truth. I swear it. So, JB calls me up and says, so, I want you to do this lecture. And I go, I have no lecture. What am I going to do? I don't have any skills that I can teach you. I couldn't do a double lift to save my life. And he goes, no, you can just do a Q&A thing. And it took us a while to figure out this technology. And in the process of figuring out how we're going to do this, I just started experimenting and figured out, hey, I can do my own talk show.
Yeah.
So this, for the last week, I've had all these friends of mine on. And it kind of was all born because of this thing that we talked about. So for that, I say thank you.
Oh,
I appreciate it.
If I'm okay to say you're welcome. But, you know, I am more grateful for you, for your life, Franz, for what you do in magic.
Did they hit the like button? I can't see. Did they hit
that? Oh, they hit it already. Like this page. That's why we are here. Like this page. Because if it reaches 100,000 likes, Franz is gonna do something different.
What am I gonna do?
I heard you're gonna eat something. I don't know. I'm not gonna mention that.
That's so sad. About a week ago, it's a long story, but my wife's Japanese, and so we're in Little Tokyo. So I found this fish uterus, and it's pretty disgusting. And so I told my Facebook friends, if I can hit 18,000 likes, I think I will eat the fish uterus. Problem is, like a week ago, and it's in the refrigerator, and it's not really something that anybody should eat anymore. I don't think that it is really edible. So
I thought it was John's idea, you know.
No. So I might have to get a new fish uterus.
Okay. Yeah. So I have another question. Right?
Yes. Yeah. So,
you get booked. You said you did some free shows a lot, right? So.
A lot of free shows.
So that's how you get started. What's the first produced live show? Can you still remember?
When was it? Well, the first one was that birthday party I was telling you about.
A public show, a paid public show.
That was it. That was a birthday party. And then more birthday parties. And then, you know, we have something here called the Cub Scouts. And they have like little blue and gold banquets. So I was doing that. Like a lot of little church organizations, anywhere I could. And I was doing shows for $30, $40, $50. If I could make $100 on a show, that was a big day, you know? And the whole time I'm building illusions, because after about 2 or 3 years of this, it was all about building magic out of cardboard, but out of wood. So I started building my own sword box, and I figured out this levitation, and I figured out these three fluorescent lights that passed through my girlfriend at the time.
I like that.
So I just kind of kept inventing stuff, and every penny that I made, I would spend on more materials, on more plywood, on more glue and gaffer tape and screws and whatever it took. So I was never making any money, but I was building up a repertoire, you know, and at the same time, learning how to talk to an audience.
After
probably 3-4 years of this, I kind of got good at connecting with an audience.
And then
everything kind of started for me at the University of Michigan and Eastern Michigan University. But on that note, something that it took me a long time to realize that it has nothing to do with the equipment. Don't matter. The technology doesn't matter. What matters, only one thing that matters, and that is your ability as a performer to connect with your audience.
You need to
make that audience believe that you are genuinely a friend. At the end of the show, they should want to take you home to dinner. That's who you need to be. And it doesn't matter how you get there. You can do it with big boxes, or you can do that. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what the vehicle is, you know?
Yeah, I know. So, Franz, you know, seeing all the videos earlier, your illusions are amazing. I mean, and for me, the design is very modern, and it is also based on technology and all that kind of stuff. I just want to ask, Franz, what is your background? I mean, are you an engineer, a designer?
I studied voice. I studied... voice major, trumpet minor.
My degree
was going to be a musical theater, but I never graduated. But on that note, about 3 months ago, I got a call from my university that they're giving me an honorary master's of theater, even though I never graduated. So the lesson is, kids, don't go to school, don't graduate, because if you wait long enough, they'll give it to you for free. So, and then this whole virus thing happened. I was supposed to do the commencement speech for the class of 2020 at the university. And again, I thought, what the hell am I going to tell these people? Because I'm a really bad example. I never graduated. You know, I never finished. And here I am. So it's kind of lucky that I didn't have to give that speech, because I'm at a bit of a loss, you know.
Oh, I'm sure they're all looking forward to that speech. So, Franz, you're telling me that you're being creative.
Hey, I see that David Haynes is listening. David Haynes, illusionist, East Coast. If you tune in on the 19th to my show, David Haynes is going to debut a brand new illusion that he's working on.
Yeah, you mentioned that earlier. I'm looking forward to that as well.
Yeah.
So all those watching, okay? Hey, wait. Hit the like button first, okay? Like.
All right. That's it. All right. Good. I'm counting on you here.
What's your favorite gummy bear?
You know, I like Clear. I'm a big fan of Clear. The reason he's bringing this up is David is one of my, I don't even know what to call it. He does my show. Because as a producer, I learned I need to be in multiple places at the same time. Because if it's me on stage, I can only be in one place. So I've got magicians like David who I've taught my show, and then he can go out and be me to a degree. Certainly in Asia, where one guy is another white guy. But in Sanya, David stood in for me so that I could direct and I could produce that show and see what it looks like from the audience.
Yeah.
So one thing he learned very quickly is that all of my low chambers, if you're not a magician, a low chamber is kind of the secret compartment where you can't be seen. All of my low chambers where I've got to kind of be there and wait for a while, I have these little compartments with gummy bears so that I can be popping gummy bears while I'm waiting for my time to pop out of the box.
So that's the gummy bear story.
Exactly. So that's why David's asking, what's my favorite flavor?
Yeah. Here's a question from Anchai Kumawat.
Anchai.
According to you, what is the
India. From India. Yeah. I know, Anchai.
What is the quality of an illusionist should have on stage?
As I said before, you got two things. One, number one and most important, you need to connect with your audience. Your audience needs to believe that you like them, that you are their friend, and that you genuinely care about them. Number one. Number two, you need to control your space, especially if you start getting into big illusions. It's very easy to be eaten up by the size of the props. And so as an illusionist, you need to make certain that the audience at all times not only believes that you have control of the space, but that everything is happening because of you. You know, if a car appears on a platform, it appears because you as the illusionist have willed it to and made it appear. If you weren't there, that car wouldn't appear. So that's really, the illusionist needs to maintain control. He needs to appear in complete control. And you got to have that connection with an audience, you know?
Yeah. So the connection is really important. It doesn't matter how small or how big the magic is.
No difference. Makes no difference at all.
That's good. So, Franz, do you have a manager? How do you get this large book?
I have a manager. I had a manager. I had a manager for 19 years.
You even need one.
I mean, it's a weird story. What happened is I got to a point in my career where I no longer needed the manager. So what I need is an attorney, you know? What I need is a legal team. So right now my wife has been running my business out for the last 10 years.
Okay.
She's really, I think you met her actually. So she's Japanese and has this good business sensibility. So she kind of runs the money and runs the logistics and all of that stuff.
Okay.
And then I've got a killer team of people that I've collected from all over the world. I was saying four of my technicians are Filipino. My lighting designer is Japanese. My graphics guy is in Malaysia. My engineer, India. Yeah. So these are people that I've collected from and from Thailand as my customer and on and on and on. So these are really, really great people that I've collected as I've traveled around the world and put together this this A team, you know? So I've come to realize that even more important than a manager is that team of people around you. These people have been with me in some cases for 30 years. You know, my customer started in Michael Jackson 1984, 36 years ago. That's how long we've been working together, you know? And then she moved to Thailand and now I have to fly her in from Bangkok every time, you know.
Oh, you know what? You were like, what do they call this? Who's the leader of X-Men? Wherein he collects all this 18 people in this house. The it's like you, man. The bald guy. I forgot his name. It's Professor X, I think, or you know, you like.
Yeah. It's you. Wheelchair guy, right? It's he was also the Star Trek captain.
So that's who you are. In every place that you go to perform, I see you have this good character of connecting to people, and people loves you, they love you back, and you know, and you've been helping a lot of, not just magicians, you know, a lot of people as well, right? So I can see that, you know, and I also heard that Greg started with, did he start with you?
That's right. I think that was his first big gig. I saw him at a magic convention in Michigan. See? Abbott's Magic get together, and him and Greg Froon and Jason Byrne were doing a dove act together.
Yeah, so
I hired them as my special guest act for a show that I did with Taiwan, Taipei. And then from there, kind of launched them. I feel like I've done that for a lot of magicians, actually.
Yeah, and you know, Franz, just to tell you honestly, I see you like this is going to be your legacy. Now, beyond the magic and the entertainment value that you give. It's the relationship. It's you helping how you help us and other magicians as well, man. So
I don't
have a good heart.
I don't have kids. Maybe that is my legacy. But you know, the other thing that I've noticed is certainly for me, and I think this is true for most performers, for magicians, you go through three phases. The first thing is you want ego. You want You want strangers to tell That's you good. You're like great. That. You want to be on stage. Yeah. You want to look great. You want girls to fall all over you. You know, that's why you're in it. And a lot of magicians are at that place. It's all over the internet. Wow. You can see these guys, you know?
Yeah.
Next step, once you've been doing that for a while and once you kind of got that, then you ask yourself, well, how am I going to make a living at this? How am I going to support myself, support my family? How am I going to survive doing magic? And so your brain kind of flips and it kind of moves from the right side of your brain over to the left side, a little bit more logical, right? So now you've got your system figured out to where you're making money. You're middle-aged, 40s, 50s, and then you go, so why am I really doing this? You know, I'm making money. I've got a comfortable life. I'm doing what I want to do. But why? What's the point? And I think that's when you realize it's not about the moment, but it's about what you can do for others and for others in the future. You know, how do you move the art forward? How do you push magic forward so that it doesn't become a craft? So it's not you're making the same shoe over and over and over. All the guys out there that are doing a snowstorm, that are doing Kevin James's bowling ball, you know, all those guys, you know, that's not art, that's craft. You're making the perfect Kevin James shoe, you know?
Okay.
What you need to do is create something new and push the art forward.
That's good.
As you do that, the art moves forward. Wow. And for me, I feel like it's my mission to get that message out there.
Yeah.
Get magicians of whatever age thinking differently where they realize I've got to do new magic. I've got to do my own magic. I've got to do magic that communicates who I am as a magician and push that art form forward. So that's kind of the third step. The third step is, okay, well, so now that you're making money, what's it all for? What's the greater cause? You know, we're all on this planet, just blip, and we're gone, you know?
Wow.
So in this little blip that we're here, how are we going to make this place better? How are we going to, you know, and in, for most of us, that means how are we going to make our little community of magicians happier and better in the future? So, again, probably a bigger answer than you're looking forward, but there you go.
Yeah, wow, that's precious, man. Coming from you, coming from the master, that's a good thing. So maybe you can watch the replay or we'll upload it somewhere in my show or that's a good thing to say. So, Franz, we have a question again from Anchai Kumawat from India. During this much live ticket show so far, is it happened any time with you that you got very few people as an audience? If it happened, when and where and how much people? Where? What are your thoughts?
Well, it happened in China. It happened in China 2 months ago. I designed this 2,000-seat theater, and we opened to 2,000 seats. And then the COVID started kicking in and our audience started dropping and went to 2,000 to 1,500 to 1,000. By the time we did our last show, it was like 20 people in the audience, you know? So it's, you know, but even though there's 20 people, those 20 people are your greatest fans because they actually, they went out there and they risked their lives. You know, they're all sitting there with their masks on watching the show, you know, going, oh, wow, it's magic time, you know? So I remember that audience. It was 20 or 30 people all with masks on. And I thought, I will never have a more dedicated audience in my entire life. But economically speaking, I've had times where I have produced the show myself, as well as what we call in the States being the executive producer, which means putting in the money.
Yeah.
And I remember many times standing on stage and counting people in the audience and asking myself, am I paying money to be on stage right now or am I making money being on stage?
And it's
a really tough position to be in because you stop being an artist. You're now a businessman, you know, and so it's not an enjoyable experience. So I've learned that for me anyway, it's foolish for me to be the executive producer, to be the money guy to my own show. I rather what I do is I will create the product, put it out there, and then have somebody else spend the money to market it and advertise it and promote it, because they can focus on that full time. That's a full time job.
Yeah.
Which I, as a producer performer, is just not enough hours in the day, you know?
Yeah. So you designate. Yeah. So you get people to do a job. You don't do everything. Like,
you got to find somebody else. You know what it is? The key to everything is making somebody with money believe you.
Yeah.
If that person with money believes,
making that person,
yep, they have to believe that you can make them more money.
Yeah.
And you win. That's it. That's the whole game.
That's good. So, Franz, today there's technology, there's YouTube, social media, right? So, what do you think about? I'm not sure if this is a very confidential question or something. There's a lot of revelation online. What are your thoughts about? Yeah.
You know, sometimes I'll be doing a show and I will see people in the audience on their phones Googling me to see how the trick works while they're in the audience watching whatever illusion I'm doing.
That's crazy. So
it's, you know, I was talking to Lu Chen is a buddy of mine. In fact, Lu Chen and I worked together in Happy Valley in China in that same show in Shenzhen. And then, of course, Chen skyrockets and becomes a superstar. And by the way, wonderful guy. Great guy.
So
I was talking to him a couple of years ago about this, because he's in the worst position of any of us, because his market is predominantly China.
Yes.
When he does anything on television, 10 minutes later, it's already on social media with the explanation of how it works.
Wow.
So how do you fight that? And his philosophy is that you got to stop worrying about the secret. It's got to be just in the moment. Magic is in the moment. And if you can entertain them for the moment, I'm probably recapping it somewhat incorrectly. But I think that's the best way that any of us can handle this, because the secret's out there. You know, the secret doesn't matter anymore. What's important is how happy can you make your audience feel before they know the secret for that little sliver of time there. By the way, let me say something.
Okay.
A lot of my stuff is very mechanical. There's a lot of engineering going on.
Yeah.
And I'm really proud of that, because sometimes it's cooler to watch how something works from backstage than it is to watch it from the audience.
Yeah.
And when my stuff is revealed, yeah, it pisses me off that it's revealed, but it's also kind of cool for me to say, look, this is the engineering behind this, because that's not something a magician can really do. Don't get me wrong. I don't have to expose my stuff. If I find you, I will. You try to find a silver lining, and that's at least my way of dealing with it.
Yeah. So with all the technology now, it's 2020. How long have you been doing magic professionally, if you don't mind?
Well, I'm 57. My
don't look 57, man.
But I read at a 59-year-old level. So I think I did my first, that birthday party show I was telling you about, I think I was 13. So that means 44 years, something like that.
Yeah, that's good. You don't look like your age now, Franz.
You're very kind.
I have a question to you, man. So what do you think about magic today, and where is it heading in the future? What do you think, like, as of now, after the coronavirus, what's the future of magic?
Well, that's really the big question. Anybody who knows that, you're a billionaire, you know? It's going to be different. I think it's going to take a while for magic to find its place again. I think magic has an advantage because it can be done without a lot of production. You don't need all the toys around you, or I do actually, but you don't if you have, you know, manipulation skills. So that means that people will be able to afford magicians sooner than they will be able to afford a band, you know, or a dance crew or a play or anything theatrical, because it's one guy. So I think a lot of guys are going to be able to take advantage of that. It's going to be hard to find that work because the whole world economy is going to suck for so long, you know, trying to find that place where you can work by yourself. But I think those guys are going to shine. For guys like me, it's going to be tough because, again, the whole world economy has dropped. And it costs a ton of money for, forget about any kind of money that I make, just to produce the show. It's crazy money, you know? So it's going to be a while until companies are able to spend that kind of money on big shows. But it's going to mutate. And I think the guys that are going to survive, the guys that are going to rise to the top, are the guys who can think outside of the box, think creatively, and figure out how to mold themselves to fit this new, you know, world economy.
Yeah, that's good. So I was thinking about this, you know, like, it's coronavirus. There's a lot of canceled shows. So specifically, I'm speaking here in the Philippines. So I got a lot of canceled and rescheduled shows. So one of my mentor here, Lou Hilario, he says, maybe after the corona, we should lower a bit our talent fee or professional fee.
I think a lot. I think you're going to lower a lot because everybody's going to be out of work. Everybody. So if you're for a guy like me, my company hires other magicians to be in these productions.
Yeah.
The same guys, if I could get a guy for 5,000 US bucks a week, right? That's a pretty good act. I'm not going to name names, but that'll get you somebody good.
Yeah.
That guy now is probably going to be happy with 3,000 bucks a week. Yeah. But I also know
I'm happy with that. France.
But there's going to be another guy that'll do just as good for 2,000 and another guy who's going to beat that. So it's always going to be, as a producer, I'm going to look to whoever is going to give me an acceptable product, a product that will work for the lowest possible price. Wow. So we're all going to be competing with each other, and it's going to be happening with me. I'm going to be competing with The Illusionists and all these other shows that are all going to be dropping their prices. So We're gonna be hurting for a while, but again, the smart producers, the smart artists, the creative artists are gonna figure out how to spin their product and figure out how to now create a new product for less money, still put out there, you know, a first-rate thing. It's gonna be a weird ride. It's gonna take a while, years, I think, you know.
It's really nice to get this insight from you, Franz, because you are not just a talent. You are also speaking from a producer's point of view. So you see, we are getting this from a business point of view. And yes, that's very, very important. So I have a question here from Mac Florendo. It's from a message last night. He says, many young magicians starts with close-up magic tricks. This is for a live show. How can we transition from close-up magic tricks to large-scale and big production? Is there a...
Cardboard boxes, unless you're rich. If you got money, then go buy yourself some boxes. You know, but if not, just do what I did. Just make your own stuff and just try and fail and learn.
Yeah.
You know, or if you got a rich uncle somewhere, then go get yourself a CRuz. You know, it's a great trick, you know. But if you're going to do a CRuz, then, and let me hold that thought for a second. I'm going to jump over to the side.
Okay.
Michael Jackson, friend of mine for 26 years. Mm-hmm. When I first met him, within the first 2-3 weeks or so, he said something to me that stayed with me to this day. He said, "Franz, whatever you do, do it different and better than anybody else."
Michael Jackson.
Do it different and better than anybody else, right? Mm-hmm. As a magician, I wake up with that every day. So go back to the guy that I just told to go buy a CRuz, right? Now, I'm not a big proponent, as you know, of doing other people's magic.
Okay.
But if you're going to jump in and you don't have the resources or you don't feel like you trust yourself creatively, then buy something like that. There's some great stuff out there. But figure out how to do it different and better than anybody else. Different and better, you know? So if you've got to do somebody else's magic, do it different, better, make it your own. And that's you're very going to quickly, you're going to figure out who you are as an illusionist. And that's how you're going to grow and become an illusionist.
We have a comment from Jay Port. He says, excellent advice, different and better than anyone else. Thank you, Franz.
Jay has a giraffe behind him, I believe.
Yeah. Someone's asking also, what's that at your back? You have a zigzag miniature over there?
That I was actually going to talk about in one of my my little...
That's Kurt Chee.
I built that when I was 18 years old. So you can do 30, long time ago. It is for a rubber chicken. So I used to put a rubber chicken in there, and then I would zigzag the rubber chicken. So I was talking to Kevin James. I was doing this little quarantine talk thing I was telling you about with my buddy Kevin James. And he saw me do that at this convention in like 1980, I think. So I thought, oh, it's in my attic. I've got all this free time right now because I'm stuck at home. So I'm cleaning out my attic, and it's like a trip down memory lane. And I found the zigzag. So I brought down the zigzag, and I was going to use it for my little show tomorrow. But I don't have a rubber chicken. The chicken, which is made out of rubber, completely decomposed. 880, 90, 2000. That was 40 years ago. 40 years ago. So the chicken is no longer with us, but the box that I built is there.
Is that for sale?
No.
I was kidding. I was kidding. So what could be your advice for the Philippine magic industry? Where it is not that advanced here in the Philippines. So that's from Mac Florendo. What could be your advice in the Philippine magic industry?
Well, you know, and you said it's because it's not that advanced?
I don't know. This is his question from Mac Florendo.
I've heard this from other places around the world, like India and Bangladesh. You always hear, well, what do we do? We're not, you know, we don't have the same money as you. There's not as much magic going on. And I always feel like the very nature of that question is the answer to the question. The fact that he feels like there's not that much magic in the Philippines, that's a huge, huge benefit to him. You know, when I wake up every morning, I'm competing with thousands of other guys. You know, in Los Angeles, there's 300 guys, you know, and everything I do, everywhere I go in my career, I look behind me and I know there's 300 guys working like hell to replace me every single day, you know? So it becomes this race, right? In markets like the Philippines, where you don't have 300 people trying to knock you out of the game, it's wide open. You know, it's much easier as an artist to break into a market when you're almost the only show in town, you know? So you need to take advantage that there's not that much going on in the Philippines, and do it now, because in 10 years, there will be many magicians, and in 20 years, there's going to be as many as Los Angeles, and then you're going to go, ah, crap, I should have done it in 2020, you know?
Yeah.
You got to start right now and aggressively begin your career, because it's wide open. The door is way open for you. And that's not true in Germany or Japan or the States, you know? Even Mexico. Mexico City's got hundreds of magicians, and they're all fighting each other for that one spot in that one show. You don't have that, you know?
Yeah, I have another question. You know, speaking about competition, and there's like what you said, there's 300. Well, of course, there's increasingly a number of magicians all over. So I have my own perception on this. I want to see what's your perception. Should you be considering yourself, should your attitude be in the competition, or you should just focus on your own?
You're talking about magic competitions?
Yeah, no, I mean, you, like you said, there are other magicians out there. Like, other magicians, they look like
they're doing. I don't know that mine is the right answer. I don't look at any other magicians. I don't know that that's the right answer, because I may be working on something that they're already doing, you know, as I was saying, reinventing the wheel. So for me, I ignore them, and I just move forward as fast as I can. And I really don't know what's going on. It sounds so stupid. I've got all of my friends are in the illusionists, Kevin and and Jeff McBride and Lou Cavados and all those guys, they're all really good friends for 30 years. I have never seen The Illusionists. I have never seen that show. I should see the show. I should make the time to see the show, but I just haven't done it. You know? So it's
so busy.
I don't really worry about anybody else. It's just all I care about is creating that next thing, making that next thing that didn't exist before and putting it out there and seeing what happens. That is such a rush. It's everything.
Amazing. From Lou Hilario, when do you decide to dispose of your illusions? When do you decide to dispose
of them?
Right, I don't know.
Right now, I'm going into my attic and I'm not the zigzag, but I got rid of a lot of stuff. It's never, because all the stuff that I've got, it's stupid money. You know, all of my illusions are prototypes. I don't have a warehouse full of mismades and sup trunks and what have you. They're all they're all first time. So where, for example, and we'll go back to a CubeSat. You can, how much does a CubeSat cost? Danny Morano can tell you. I think he owns one.
Danny knows, maybe around 3,000 or
3,000 bucks, right? I guarantee you to develop the CubeSat probably costs 10,000 bucks, because that's the price of research and development and of testing and of
trials and getting it
right. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So if you got the first one, you spend 10 G's for that, you can build the next one for about 2,000 and sell it for 3,000 to make some money. Everything that I do, because it's my own, I'm spending a ridiculous amount of money on. Saw some of the video, a thing where I cut a girl into, four girls get cut up and then spin. That illusion cost $360,000. All of my stuff is averaging at the low end, 50 or 60,000. At the high end, 300,000 and higher, 400,000 in some cases. So it's ridiculous money, you know. And it's not my money. I get somebody else to pay for it. I get other companies to pay for it. And then when the show is done, I keep the props. So that's how I'm able to collect all this stuff. Yeah. So it's not like I'm throwing away props anytime soon. But what I did do in spring of this year is I've got a warehouse in Orlando, Michigan, Tokyo, and two in China, and and LA. I say LA. I've got two in LA, and the problem is in Los Angeles, property prices are going so high, and I don't own the warehouse. I just rent the warehouse that I'm paying a fortune to store all this stuff. So in spring of this year, I took what would have been six sea containers went to my warehouse in China. One sea container went to my place in Detroit. Yeah. The place in Detroit is actually owned by Kerry Kaz, my stage manager. That's all another story. So now I've got 40-foot sea containers worth of stuff that
it's huge.
To China. It's a lot of stuff. Yeah. It's a sea container is 40 feet by 8 feet by about 8 feet.
Yeah.
So all that stuff was sitting there because China is about a third of the price to store than the United States. And then things started getting weird in between Donald Trump and Xi. And suddenly the price of aluminum goes up and trade starts getting real weird. And now I don't have the ability of bringing stuff from the United States to China. Luckily, I had just moved these six sea containers there. So the show that we opened in Sanya is entirely made of stuff that came from that load that I happen to have moved over into the warehouse there. So it's at this point in my career, I don't really get rid of anything. I just kind of move it around. I'm just sort of cups and balls with it, you know?
Yeah.
Again, a really long answer.
Yeah. And you know what? One good thing that I've learned from that previous answer is you're doing prototypes. So for me, that is maybe that's the reason why you are Franz Harary, because you believe in prototyping, you know? You're not afraid to commit mistakes, so you just do it. And then, you know, failure is part of improvement, right?
If it's not a prototype, it's not new, you know?
Absolutely,
so unless you're prototyping, you're building somebody else's stuff.
That's good. I do believe in prototyping. Hey, Franz, we've been talking for more than 60 minutes. Are you still okay for a few minutes?
I'm good. You know, let's do like 3-4 questions and then roll another video. Actually, let's do this. Let's roll a video right now, yeah. And then we'll do like 3 more big questions, and then we'll finish it there. Oh, before that, right. Hit the like button. Hit the like button.
Yeah, like. Smash it. Like now.
All right. Carrie, let's play 2 more segments, if you would.
Magically needs to mean something to the audience, even though I'm distorting reality to my viewer.
That's good.
It's very real. Why not see if you can't use magic as a tool to realize this fantastic world that's already going on in your imagination? One, two, three.
Oh my God. Oh my God. So let's take a couple more questions.
Yeah. Before the question, David Haynes mentioned something that Franz saved Missy's life.
He's David Haynes, you're it's late for you. What time is it for David Haynes? 11, 12, 1, 30 in the morning. Go to sleep, David. I put enough pressure on him already. He's got to do this new illusion for us.
Yeah, yeah. So another question is, there's another question here. I just saw it a while ago. When is the right time to retire in magic? Let me see.
The right time to retire?
Yeah.
I sure as hell am never retiring. I think people retire because they don't love what they do. You know? Mm-hmm. Why the hell would you retire if you love in what magic. You do?
It's art.
I suppose you retire when you don't like it anymore.
Yeah, that's true.
But I can't imagine what that would be like. I'm going to be doing this till I'm dead. And hopefully after that.
Yeah. Wow, in heaven. Okay. So whatever. Franz, what's next? After Macau? I think
after Macau, well, I've got the show in Sanya. So Sanya is supposed to open God knows when. As I look into my crystal ball, I think... July, maybe? I don't know, but I think China is going to be open before the United States. So we jump back to Sanya. I'm designing because I had a lot of time in my house here, and it looks like I'm going to have a couple more months. I've been designing stuff like crazy. So I'm going to try to put new magic into the Sanya show. Then I've got a show that continues to operate in Tokyo. That's also stopped, come to think of it. So who knows? You know, I have no idea. I gotta wait to see what this planet becomes when all this is done. But in theory, I'm going to have my normal set of shows that I'm doing, you know. Missy Elliott, hopefully, will jump back in again.
Wow. Wow. And I'm sure we're going to miss these live shows that you're doing.
That's one thing. I hope that I don't have time to do these live shows. I hope. I can tell you right now, if I'm doing these shows, then I'm out of work.
Yeah.
But it's a good time to hype the show one more time. 8:00 in the morning, Filipino time. 8:00 right at this channel. It's Quarantine Talk. Tomorrow is Victor and Diamond, then Gabe Blackstone, then Shin Lim and Marie Sawchuk, Jeff Hobson. Tune in. And David Haynes, yes. That's what very big show. We don't get him.
You promote him in advance, yeah. You said he's going to launch something new.
That's right. Hey, you know, let's take a moment and meet my stage manager. He's also been acting as my engineer this entire time. Carrie, bring yourself up.
Hello, Carrie.
Everybody say hi to Carrie.
Carrie, good evening.
Carrie's in Detroit, where it is freaking late right now. Carrie, thank you for staying awake and clicking buttons for us here.
Anytime.
Yeah.
Carrie, by the way, Carrie himself is an illusionist. He's one of the guys like David who does my show. All these guys, they do their own version of my show. I never want to have a clone of me, as you can tell looking at Carrie. There you go. That is not a clone of me right there.
Yeah, thank you, Carrie.
Harary, is there anything you want to jump in here and say? You've been listening to this whole thing, much to your chagrin, I'm sure.
No, I mean, unless, did you want to cover the Missy Elliott ABDC story that David was talking about? It's really good. It's a really fun story.
Yeah. Yeah.
The earthquake story?
Yeah. Burned?
Yeah. Yeah. So this was about, Jesus, this was about 10 years ago. So I was saying I've done a lot of magic with Missy Elliott. And one time I was doing this thing where she's inside, I want to say inside, but she's going to magically appear surrounded with fire. So she's inside this secret box that the audience can't see. We'll call it a low chamber. And yes, there are little gummy bears inside there for her if she wanted them. So we're rehearsing on a big soundstage in Los Angeles, and suddenly there's an earthquake, and the whole thing starts to rattle. And I am petrified of earthquakes. I actually built myself an earthquake-proof bed with a whole steel roll cage and what have you. So I'm really afraid of earthquakes. So as soon as the studio starts to shake, all like 150 technicians run out of the building as fast as they can. And I realize that on stage, Missy is inside this little secret box and has no idea what's going on. She just notices that the box is moving. So I think I am going to be a hero. And I'm going to run on stage. And while the world is moving and shaking, I'm making my way onto the stage. I get to the stage just as the earthquake stops. I open this trap door and I go, Missy, come on out. She goes, what? I go, earthquake, get on out. So I'm thinking, I am a hero. I have saved Missy Elliott.
Okay.
So I take her and I walk out of the stage and I'm waiting to get a hero's welcome. Celebration, perhaps in song, a little bit of dancing. But what I see is 150 technicians, all union guys, smoking their cigarettes on their cell phone, completely ignoring me. And I realized that none of them wanted to acknowledge me because they all ran for their lives and ignored this, you know, gazillion-dollar artist who is stuck in a box.
Yeah, he's stuck in a box. You're a hero to me.
All right.
And to all of us.
Harry, thanks again. I appreciate all your work. We're going to do, let's do three more questions with JB and see what happens.
Yeah, and we're going to end this up. Yeah. So, Franz, did you have any marketed, because I know you created a lot and most of your shows are original. Did you ever try to, you know, offer it, any one of those creations of yours out there, you know, publicly?
Offer the creations?
Did you ever sell any effects?
I invented the twister, which very few magicians know about. So I marketed that, but honestly, I lost control of it because so many copies have been made that I just lost. But what's interesting about the twister is I built it when I had no money. So I built the first one out of plywood. And I was in Los Angeles, and I just had an old saw in my backyard and some tape. So I came up with the head spinner.
Yeah.
But I built it out of 2x4s, way too big.
Yeah.
But I didn't have any money for real materials or real tools. So it's really, really tall. Taller than it should be. It should be a tight little box, but it's really tall. So that illusion has been ripped off so many times all over the world. And not only did they rip off the trick, they ripped off the design flaw, because if you look at twisters, a lot of them have really high head boxes for no reason. There's no reason in the world that these boxes should be so high, other than that I didn't have the money to build it correctly. So that's one thing. Then I've got a slicer, a cutting and ninesel. I've sold a bunch of those. And then I've designed stuff for other magicians. Pretty much stopped doing that, honestly, because it's a lot of work. It's when you sell something to another magician, you're marrying them, because so long as they own that piece of equipment, every tiny little thing that goes wrong, they're on the phone. Mr. Harary, I can't figure out how to get this match to work and blah. This goes on forever and ever and ever.
Yeah,
so,
I know what you're talking about.
Doing
that. The after sales.
You know who you want to talk to? You want to talk to Kevin James, because he's got stories. Kevin has sold so many pieces of magic to so many magicians, and he is haunted by those magicians 24 hours a day.
Oh, But I can see that.
You know, I think it's great because for Kevin, it's an industry. It's a moneymaker. He's got so many out there. All of Kevin's magic is so perfectly designed for the working magician that you don't need a lot of production. You don't need light and sound and video. It's self-working. So it's so brilliant that, you know, my hat is off to the guy, you know?
I don't know if I'm aware of, but is there any illusion plan book that you ever released, or are you planning to?
Me? No. No interest. Why? Can't think
That's
of
yours,
a reason.
Right?
I just can't think of any reason why. Maybe when I'm dead. When I'm dead, somebody, Carrie probably. What'll happen is when I'm dead, Carrie will go through my attic. He'll find a bunch of books and drawings. And he will release them.
Wow.
That's when they'll come in. Yeah.
That is good. So, Franz, it was such an amazing time with you. It was productive. You know, it was a productive afternoon here in the Philippines. A lot of magicians are grateful. Personally, I am grateful. And I know for inviting me in your page.
Hit the like button.
Hit the like button first.
Hit the like button.
Come on. 18,000 is something.
Join me tomorrow, 8 o'clock in the morning Filipino time, for Victor and Diamond, and then tune after that. And you know what they should do? They should tell other magic groups, tell other little magic organizations about this, share this with all these other organizations.
Yeah, I've been sharing your calendar to the private groups, so it's just the time difference.
Perfect.
Yeah,
so
they watch the replay.
We need like some outro music or something we can play for a big ending to all this. Do you have anything? So, maybe you can sing. You want to sing? You're Filipino, so of course you sing, right? Is that a stereotype?
Hey, there's a comment here. You said you're a singer, so someone's asking for a sample from Franz Hararay. Maybe
all right, I will sing the outro. Anybody else we want to say goodbye to? We're going to close it up.
Yeah, hey, thank you very much for watching, guys. This is JB De La Cruz, Inspired Magic Talk Live with Franz Hararay. It's been very productive. Thank you for sharing all your insights, man. We are very inspired right now.
You know what we should do together? What's a song we both know? Happy Birthday. You know Happy Birthday, right? Okay. So together, we will sing Happy Birthday, and that'll be our outro, okay?
Are you serious? Okay.
Let's do it. Are you ready?
Ready.
At the count of three. One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy, have friends.